Hello and welcome to this presentation from the Urban Penguin. My name is Andrew Mallett and today we're going to take a look at converting LILO, the Linux loader, through to a legacy grub, a grand unified bootloader. As always, you can find these videos on theurbanpenguin.com. If you're on Twitter, you can follow me at The Urban Penguin, and on Facebook you'll be able to find and like my page as The Urban Penguin. So we can start this demonstration then on a SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 10 machine. So it's a little bit old, but I wanted to demonstrate having an older bootloader, the LILO bootloader, and looking at how we can upgrade that. And we're going to do it on two machines. One that has just the single root file system with nothing mounted into it, and then on another machine where we use a separate boot partition with the directory /boot that is partitioned up separately. So this is a machine that has the single root file system, and as I say, this is the LILO, the Linux loader, bootloader. As any bootloader allows us to select multiple operating systems, in this case it happens to be both SUSE Linux Enterprise Server 10 but with different kernel options. Additionally, within the boot options dialog box we can specify, such as I've done here, putting in run level 3, so we're able to boot to run level 3 rather than using the initialization default. So we can adjust the parameters a little bit with LILO, but it tends to be relatively few machines that use it now, and there are certain amount of limitations within LILO, such as it can't be used within Xen virtual machines. As we boot up, we can see then that it does load the kernel, and of course then we'll boot the operating system as instructed, and essentially we see this process running through now. In the LPI level 1 certification, currently the exam concentrates on grub and what we would now call legacy grub, or grub version 1. Grub 2 is also out and we'll have some videos on Grub 2, but the exam currently concentrates, as far as the bootloader, as the main bootloader in your enterprise, Grub or Grub Legacy. Grub 2 is starting to make its way into the system, and we're starting to see that on our Red Hat Enterprise Linux 7 machine, which is just out in beta at the moment. So booting up with a Linux loader then, we can boot into our operating system. We've gone to the command line only, run level 3, and I've been able to log in as my root user. As I was saying, on this machine we've got a single partition for our file system. We have a swap partition and we have a file system partition that is mounted through to root. We can use parted or we can use fdisk to display the partition information. So we can see with parted, we can see we've got a swap partition, which is partition 1, and then we've got a bootable partition of type 83, which is our standard Linux partition, which is partition 2. So our complete root file system, including the directory boot, is all on the one partition. If we've got a simple file system with nothing particularly clever set up on it, then the bootloader will have no problems accessing the /boot directory. We can also see this with fdisk. So if I go into fdisk and I can print, I could also use fdisk -l, it would show me the same information. We can see the asterisk against SDA2 shows that it's the bootable partition. We can see we've got the flag boot against it in parted, and the asterisk says that this is the bootable partition. This is very important when we're looking at grub, when we understand the terminology that grub uses. Using the mount command, again, of course, we can display this information. So we can see that SDA2 is mounted to the root file system, and we don't have any other file systems other than our virtual file systems for proc and sysfs, etc., mounted into memory. The only file system partition we have is SDA2 mounted through to the root directory. So we're using the LILO bootloader. The LILO bootloader will point into the boot directory. For its graphical screen, it shows the boot message file, which is a CPIO archive. The kernel it can access, and we can see the VM Linux files for this. But it doesn't access symbolic links. And then the RAM disk, which contains the drivers, the initrd. These are going to be the same files that we access with the grub bootloader. Grub has its own directory, even though we're not using it, and it has drivers to access the file system. And we can see that here within the grub directory, but as yet there's no configuration file for grub. If we take a look at the LILO configuration file, that's etc, lilo.conf, we can see that we specify the boot device, so /dev/sda2, and we actually use the kernel names. For the image, that's the kernel that we're booting. And then we have labels to identify the entries. And then we have things like the append settings, the normal options we want with our kernel. So what we'll take a look at now is how we install grub and replace LILO with the grub bootloader. So we're already in the boot and grub directory. So we just need to create the grub configuration file, and that's called menu.lst, menu.lst or list. Think of it as list. Looks a bit like menu.first, but it's menu.lst. We put in normally the timeout, so this is just going to be how long we wait, so we'll display the menu for 10 seconds. The default entry, the selected entry, will be entry 0, or what we might say as our first entry. Grub counts from 0, not from 1, and that's important for our disks and partitions as well. If we want to display the graphical menu, we then use GFX menu, and we specify that we're going to find it on our first hard disk and second partition, SDA2. And we do that through HD0, comma, 1. And that's all in brackets, so GFX menu, brackets, HD0, comma, 1. That's specifying our first hard drive and second partition. Remembering grub starts counting from 0. And on that partition, we're going to look in the boot directory and for the file message. Message is a CPIO archive that then contains the overlays and graphics to put on the menu. The entries to the menu we create, and they're called stanzas, and we delimit them with the word title, so title both ends and starts a stanza. So we can have an entry for SLES 10. We really need 3 entries in each stanza to represent the root of the boot partition. Now remember, in our case, the boot partition is also our root file system. But don't confuse the term root here. We're not looking for the root of our file system, but the root of our boot directory. And our boot partition is the same as our root file system in this case. We will look at it on another machine where we have a separate boot partition so we can really understand the difference. So here again, it's going to be SDA2, or as we refer to in grub, HD0, comma, 1. The bootloader just has a much more simple way of recognizing disks and partitions and is not as, I suppose, advanced as the normal kernel mechanisms. So that's our root file system. We now must specify where we're going to find the kernel on that partition. So in this case, then, we're going to have to search into the boot directory, and we're going to find then, and we can refer to the symlink VM Linux, and then of course we put any additional kernel options that we might want. So these become the command line that we pass through to the kernel. So we're specifying where the real root file system is, so /dev/sda2, as opposed to the root of the bootable partition. We're specifying where the swap file is. We're using read-only, so we mount the root file system as read-only. It then does a file system check and will mount as read-write, but initially we mount as read-only. I'm just going to specify another option here, just run level 3, so forcing it rather than using the initialization default, we're going to specify the run level to go to at the command line. So we've got two entries. The third entry we need to put in is the RAM disk, the init RD, and this really holds the drivers that are necessary for the kernel to be accessed. So what drivers do we need to access the root file system? So any additional drivers then are supplied in the RAM disk. The RAM disk then loads first to allow us to be able to access the root file system. Now, if we want to put in multiple entries into the menu, I'm just going to cut and paste this down. I'm going to create a new title, and we're just going to put 5 after this, so I would know this is the graphical version. I'm going to change then in the kernel options, we're going to change this then to 5. So we've got one that goes to run level 3, one that goes to run level 5. The default entry is entry 0, which of course is the first entry. So that's gone through then into the menu.lst file, which is located in /boot/grub. To all intents and purposes, this is the grub configuration file. Creating the configuration file, of course, does not write anything through to the master boot record, and we can use the command grub-install to install the grub bootloader into the master boot record. So grub-install, and then we can be a little bit lenient here. We can either use the kernel name, because obviously we are running the kernel at the moment, so we can refer to it as /dev/sda. Sorry, it's just SDA, so the disk, and we can see then that it provides the mapping. So FD0 is my floppy drive, HD0 is SDA. We could do it using the kernel names or the grub name. So again, I could go through and run it as grub install HD0. The grub install will create the device map file in boot/grub, and if we cat that out, then again the same information that was shown to me, mapping HD0 through to SDA. When we're ready and when we've learned how to spell reboot, we can then reboot and see how our menu actually works. So on the reboot then, we can see that we've got the two menu items, and we can see at the bottom we see the boot options underneath those options, so run level 5, and then the default option that was the selected option of run level 3. If we hadn't interrupted the process, it would have then booted to run level 3 after 10 seconds. If I hit the escape key, I can get to a text version of this menu. But this also gives me a little bit of a toolkit into managing grub. I can hit E to edit an entry, so I can see the 3 entries in the stanza, and then I can edit any one of those 3 entries. I can also hit the command C, and we can see the sequence with the key commands shown underneath the menu, and that will give me a command line prompt, or at least a minimal grub command line prompt. I can then really run through those 3 processes and put in any information that I like, of course, so long as it points to valid information. So I can put in my root, so HD0, (1). Remember, that's pointing to the root of the bootable partition. We can then put in the kernel, and with that it's going to be slash boot and then VM, and I can use tab completion here the same way as we can within most shells, so we can see that we can see the VM Linux symbolic link. I can provide any other options I want to the kernel. So again, I'm just going to say run level 3, the others it will default to. And then the same with the RAM disk initrd, and again we're going to point to the same symbolic link, so /boot/initrd. To be able to boot, then I just type boot and then the system starts up. So again, for fault finding, the grub is really unsurpassed in this, and certainly we don't have the same options at all available in LILO. If we've got a broken system, we're going to have to boot to a recovery disk. And then of course we boot up, and once we finish booting up, we're able to log in. Now, of course, there's many more things that we can put into the grub menu, one of which is being able to control the colours of the text menu that we saw before. So if we drop back into our menu.lst and look at how we can alter the colours of the text menu, because we might not be displaying the graphical menu, or we might want to just make it a little bit more pleasant for when we shell out. Who knows why we want to make our life a little bit more colourful, but we should look at it. So if I drop back in then to the configuration file, menu.lst in boot and grub, and we just insert a new line, and we're going to use the color directive here to control the foreground and background colors. So we can be as adventurous as we like, but we've only got 16 colors to choose from. So we can then go yellow text on a blue background for our menu items. For our selected item, we can then go magenta on perhaps then a light grey background. And once we've got that in place, then we can save the changes and check that everything's up and running. As I say, we can check the grub menu for, or the grub manual for, the colours that are available. There are 16 colours in total, but only 8 can be used for the background, and then we have 16 that we can use for the foreground colours. The spellings, of course, for colour and for words like grey are going to be the American versions of the word, not the English or UK versions of the words. So I'm just going to put in an extra space here before the title, not that we particularly need it, but again for readability, keeping my global options separate from my stanzas kind of makes sense, and I'll go out and save that. And then we'll have a quick reboot, and then hopefully, of course, we're still going to see the graphical menu, the GFX menu, but now hitting the escape key, we're going to jump out to the text menu, and of course then we should be able to see the correct colours. So that gives you an idea of perhaps a little bit of customization, especially if we're not showing the graphical menu for whatever reason, then at least we can have something a little bit more pleasant, as long as you can get the colours looking perhaps a little less garish than the magenta on the light grey. So this has looked at working with our system with a single root file system, but now we've got to make sure that we understand the grub options, where we have multiple partitions and a separate boot partition. So let's take a look then on our SUSE machine, where we have a separate boot and root file system. So we have SDA1 that represents our boot file system, and SDA5, an extended or a logical partition in the extended partition, that represents the root file system. Of course we can use parted to display the information, or fdisk. So parted /dev/SDA and print, so we can see that partition number 1 is formatted with the ext3 file system, and we've got the bootable flag, and it's a type 83, so a Linux partition. We've got our extended partition, and within the extended partition we've got a logical partition, ext3, which again is Linux. It's 11 gigs, that's my root file system, and then the boot file system is just 200 megs, so relatively small. Now again, we can see this information with fdisk as well. So again, the choice of tools that we use is down to you use. But if we go through and look in that boot partition and into grub and see how the menu.lst is set up. So if we via the menu.lst, so this is a working menu file at the moment, and we can see that we point through for our display message, our graphics menu, to be HD0 and partition 0. For our stanza, we've got HD0, our first disk, and partition 0, our first partition. Of course, that's not the root file system. We can see when we mentioned the kernel itself, that is root equals slash dev slash sda5. So we have a different meaning on root depending on the context in which it is used. Root above the kernel means the root of the boot partition. When we mention the kernel, then that's where we're then talking about where is the root file system for our operating system. But of course, if we misunderstood this, if we said that our root file system, as far as the grub bootloader was concerned, then is going to be SDA5, so we put in HD0, 4. Remember that grub starts from 0. We're not going to have any problems when we do a grub install, because we only mention the disk, HD0 or SDA. So that's not a problem, it's just the partitions that now become a problem to us. If we now try and reboot, so we issue the command reboot and see what happens when we start up. But obviously we're going to try and access the partition. We're not going to be able to find the files in the partition, so all is going to be sad. So if we hit enter on our entry, we can see now that we're getting an error 15, file not found. We haven't been able to access the kernel. Automatically then, if we choose continue, it will take us into the text menu, and we can choose C to go out to the command line. So if we specify what we had entered, so SDA5 or HD0, 4. So remember, this should be pointing to the root of the boot file system. Now when we try and access the kernel, we will see, in fact, yeah, we can't access the kernel from here. So if we try and go into the boot directory, because of course in our real root file system we're going to have the boot directory, but it's empty, there is nothing in it, because we mount SDA1 into this partition. So because it's not mounted, it's only mounted when we run the init process, when we start our actual boot process, it's not booted, we won't be able to access it. So if we change where we point to, so rather than pointing to our kernel root file system, we'll point to grub's root file system. So the root of the bootable partition, HD0 and partition 1, and of course we'll enter 0 for that, so SDA1. Now when we access the kernel, we can go kernel, and of course there's no boot directory here. Boot is just a mount point for us to access the SDA1 partition. So now we can use tab completion to put in the name vmlinux. So this is going to load our kernel, and of course we can provide any options or command line parameters that we want through to our kernel. So we'll have then our real root file system as slash dev slash sda5. and we'll go to run level 3 and any other options that we want to put in, and the same or at least similar where we then reference the initialization RAM disk. Remember, the RAM disk are going to have the drivers to access the root file system if it's not natively accessible through to GRUB. Now when we're running through the boot process, we can see that we're able to access the kernel, the RAM disk, and initiate the boot process. Now, one thing we may have noticed as well, we'll allow this to boot up, but on our main GRUB screen, we're able to see all of the options that we are supplying through GRUB to the kernel. And that we might feel as not desirable. So if we go into edit our GRUB menu, when we see SLES in the menu under boot options, then we see all of the boot options that we've got. We can tidy this up. So first of all, we'll go through and correct the entry for booting to HD0 and now our correct partition 1. We'll run through the boot process, and we can see that we see all of the options supplied to the kernel. So we don't see the option to load the kernel, but the kernel arguments. Remember, our kernel arguments are going to show up in the file /proc/cmdline. So with this in place, if we boot up and we'll edit the configuration file again, our menu.lst, and we'll put some options to hide that, and we'll also control the resolution. So even though we're going through to run level 3, we can still control the screen resolution with our VGA settings. So logging in as our user root and putting in our password, and then running through and editing the configuration file, so /boot/grub/menu.lst, we should be well familiar with this by now, and we can move through to our options, moving down to the kernel line and appending to the end show ops, which kind of done the reverse. We only show the options after show ops, so any options before the word show ops are hidden from the GRUB boot options menu. So we don't put this, I suppose, peripheral information, which is not really required by the user. Still allows them to enter into the options, but they just won't see anything that's entered before. We're also then going to put in our VGA options, and I'm just going to force this through to 800 by 600 resolution. So we're going to put in decimal 0 lowercase x 314. Again, we can check in the GRUB manuals for valid entries. So checking we've got the options that we want. So we've corrected our entries, as we know, for the partition, and we've added in the VGA and show ops. So VGA is controlling the resolution of the screen, and our show ops meaning that we won't display any options. And again, we'll run through a reboot. This will be the last reboot. And now if I expand back out to the 800 by 600, when we see the screen, we won't see the additional kernel options. And of course, as we boot into this, we maintain this same resolution. So hopefully you found this useful. What we've been looking at in this section primarily is installing GRUB and the understanding of our partition numbering, and how we can replace existing bootloaders such as LILO with the GRUB or legacy GRUB bootloader. Thank you, and I look forward to seeing you back on my channel very soon.